Hi, this is Gerry van Nemelen and welcome to the webinar about domain name system, domain name system security extensions, and EURid services for its registrars. In this course, I'll begin by talking about what DNS and DNSSEC are and how you, as a registrar, can use EURid services to implement DNSSEC on your own domain names. We're going to explore how DNS works. We are looking into the DNS protocol and how it can be abused. Furthermore, we look at how DNSSEC can protect us from these exploits. And last but not least, we'll change the setup of our name service to have a DNSSEC protection for our domain names. Let's get started. This is a beginner's course. DNSSEC is hard. But in this course, only what's needed will be explained to understand the reasoning for using EURid services to protect your domain names against exploits. At the end of the course, some links will be shown for those interested to know more about DNS and DNSSEC. There is no prior knowledge about DNS required. All you need will be explained here. Surfing the internet is simple. You open your browser and type something into the address bar. If you want to go to the website of www.somedomainname.eu, for instance, you type it in the address bar of your browser, and a few moments later you have a view of the website's content. How is this possible? On the internet, everything has an address, an IP address. An IP address is a series of digits and sometimes letters, separated by decimal points or columns. Your browser uses these IP addresses to connect to the website. In our example, www.somedomainname.eu. Using an IP address to connect to a website is for most people not that easy. Generally, we are not efficient at remembering this kind of information. That's why we use domain names. A domain name is a combination of words and letters, and if they have a meaning, it becomes even easier. An IP address like 192.0.2.100 is more difficult to remember than www.somedomainname.eu. Other examples are somedomainname.com or apple.be or microsoft.eu. If you have a domain name like www.somedomain.eu, you can see that this domain name exists in three parts: EU, somedomain, and www. The EU part is the extension, or the top-level domain name, TLD. The somedomain is a child of the EU TLD, and we call this a second-level domain name. The www is a child of the second-level domain name, somedomain.eu. We call this a third-level domain name. All three parts combined, www.somedomain.eu, is a fully qualified domain name, FQDN. You can look at DNS as a big database with records. These records are resource records, RR. Each resource record exists out of several parts. It exists out of FQDN, an RR type, and resource data. If we take our example of www.somedomain.eu, www.somedomain.eu is the FQDN, fully qualified domain name. The letter A is a resource record type. And finally, we have the resource data, which, if the resource record type is A, is an IP address. 192.0.2.100. 192.0.2.100 is not the real IP address of www.somedomain.eu, but we are going to use this for this course. In this example, we can say that for the A resource record type of www.somedomain.eu, the answer is 192.0.2.100. DNS has more than 50 different types of resource records. A resource record type which is also quite important in our course is a NS resource record type. NS stands for name server. The resource record NS for somedomainname.eu gives the name services for this domain name, ns1 somedomainname.eu and ns2.somedomainname.eu. In our DNS database, we can ask for the IP addresses. A user record type for these two name servers. Each name server must have an IP address. All the information of a specific domain name in the database is called a zone file. You'll have a complete zone file, which is valid if more resource record types are needed. But that's for later. Each operating system, Microsoft Windows, macOS, Linux, iOS, Android, or something else, is configured to point to a name server. This kind of name server is a resolving name server, or also called a caching name server. When I want to go to the website of www.somedomain.eu, I open a browser on my PC and type in the address bar www.somedomain.eu and push the enter key on my keyboard. What happens now is that the browser requests the operating system for the given IP address. In our case, the IP address for www.somedomain.eu. The operating system looks in its own database for the IP address, and when not found, it will ask it to a caching name server. A caching name server looks in its own database for the information. Here we have two possible outcomes. The caching name server has the information and gives the result back to the PC. The browser connects to the website. The second possibility is that the caching name server doesn't have this data in its database. It doesn't have the A resource record of www.somedomain.eu. What happens now is that the caching name server tries to resolve this information via the internet. How does the caching name server do that? It does that in four steps. A caching name server has configured 13 IP addresses of the root name servers. This root name service has the IP address of all the TLDs name servers of the internet. .com, .org, .info, .net, .eu, .be, etc. Step 1. When the caching name server doesn't have the IP address of www.somedomain.eu, it will ask the root name server for this data. The root name server doesn't know this, but knows the EU name server's IP addresses. The root name server sends back that it doesn't know the IP address of www.somedomain.eu, but gives as additional information the IP addresses of .eu name servers. Step 2. The caching name server uses this additional information to connect directly to the EU name server and ask for the IP address of www.somedomain.eu. The name server of .eu doesn't know the answer either. It gives as additional information the IP addresses of somedomain.eu name servers. Somedomain.eu is one of its children, and the database of EU is configured with that information. In step 3, the caching name server asks the name server of somedomain.eu for the IP address of www.somedomain.eu. And now, it's been given back the IP address 192.0.2.100. In the final step, step 4, the caching name server puts this information in its database and sends the result to the initial requester, the PC. The PC gives the information to the browser, and the browser connects to the website. This process of the caching name server to find the information is called resolving, and the questions being asked by a computer to a name server is called querying. When another PC seeks to connect to the website, it asks the caching name server for the information. The caching name server looks into its database. When it finds it, the caching name server will check if the information is still valid. What I didn't say is that some extra information is given back with the answer, a time to live, TTL. A TTL is a number from 0 to 2 to the power 31, about 2 billion, and its unit is in seconds. A TTL is part of the resource record. Mostly, resource records are configured for a TTL of 3600 seconds, an hour. When a caching name server receives its answers, it puts it in the database with the TTL. When this TTL is expired, the data is not valid anymore, and the caching name server will try to resolve the information again. If the information is valid, immediately the querying is answered. No resolving needs to be done. Now, let's address DNSSEC. The normal procedure for going to a website is first, opening a browser. Second, typing an FQDN in the address bar. And three, hit the enter key. If the operating system doesn't know the IP address of the FQDN, it queries the caching name server for it. The caching name server gives an answer back, if the FQDN exists or not. The browser connects to the website and the content of the website is viewed in the browser. This is how it should work in the real world. Unfortunately, this is not always the case. Instead of going to the correct website of, for example, www.somedomain.eu with the IP address of 192.0.2.100, the browser connects to an incorrect IP address, 192.0.2.200. How is this possible? The answer is clear. The caching name server gave the wrong IP address. But how is that possible? Here, the answer is that the caching name server received the wrong IP address after resolving the FQDN. This IP address is stored into the database of the caching name server, and each time someone asks for the IP address for www.somedomain.eu, the caching name server returns the one from its database, which is wrong. For understanding how this can happen, I'm going to talk about the DNS protocol. When querying a name server, a DNS packet is sent. In a simplified format, the packet looks like this. An ID, which is 16-bit long. A name, which in most cases is an FQDN. A resource record type. Remember, there are more than 50 different kinds of them. In our example, we are going to use the A resource record type, which stands for an IP address. And there is also a class parameter, which is always the IN class. IN stands for Internet. When a name server receives a DNS packet, two things happen. With the content of the DNS packet, it knows what has been asked for and tries to get the information. If not found in its database, it resolves it via the Internet. If an address has been found, in our case for www.somedomain.eu, the IP address 192.0.2.100, this address will be sent back to the requester in almost the same format. The DNS packet sent back looks like this. The same ID from the query, the name, the resource record type, which in this case is the A resource record type, the IN class, a TTL for how long this packet is valid, the resource data, 192.0.2.100. As you can see, the answer and the query are very similar. When a network device, which can be a PC, a server, a name server, or something else, sends a DNS query, when it gets a response, the network device will check if it comes from the correct IP address. And if in the DNS packet the ID, the name, the resource record type, and the class are the same. If they are the same, the network device will consider that response an answer to the query with the same values. This mechanism is used on all network devices, also on caching name servers. If another response comes in with the same values afterwards, this packet will be ignored for that query. Only the first will be handled and will be taken as the correct one. Because the DNS protocol is so simple for accepting answers from queries, it can be easily exploited. If it like to have an incorrect IP address 192.0.2.200 in the database of a caching name server for www.somedomain.eu, I can do this easily. But first, I need to have some information. First, I need to know where the real answer will come from. I need to know the IP address for the name server of somedomain.eu. This information is easy to find. Second, I need to know what the caching name server will send as query to that name server of some domain.eu. This I know too. It will ask for the A reason trigger type in the in class. Third, I can craft a response myself. But the only thing that I don't know is the ID. The ID is a 16-bit random number, 65,536 possibilities. To solve this, I'm going to create 65,535 different DNS packets, where only the ID is different. I start with an ID of 1 and ends with the ID of 65,535. Fourth, I have to wait to the right moment to create the caching name server that I want to have the incorrect IP address. I can do queries for www.somedomain.eu and I can see in the response how long the data is still valid. When the data is not valid anymore, I know that the caching name server will again go in to resolve the IP address. When it does this, I will send 65,535 times a response to the caching name server. When my answers are received faster than the resolving of the query, the caching name server will take my response as the correct one and put that in the database. Network devices only accept the first response. All others are ignored. If I provide a TTL of 2 billion seconds, which is possible, the caching name server will keep for years my data as a valid one. Every device that queries that caching name server will get the wrong IP address as an answer. To introduce corrupt data into a caching name server is called cache poisoning. To prevent this kind of attacks, DNSSEC came into existence. How does it work? As you saw in my example, we need to know where the answer comes from. The current system doesn't work efficiently for that. We can find a solution in cryptology. In cryptology, we have something that's called asymmetric key. We have a key pair where one part can be used for signing information and the other one can be used for checking the signature if it comes from the correct writer of the data. Signing information is done with the private key of the key pair. Checking if the information has been signed by the correct person or program is done with the public part of that key pair. So, an asymmetric key exists out of two parts. A private key that can be used for signing something, and a public key that can check the signature source. For completeness, I mentioned that this asymmetric key pair can also be used for encrypting information, but this is not part of this course. When a network device queries a name server, it will get back an answer, but also a signed version of this answer. If you can check with the public key the signature and its correctness, we can say that the information received is good, or at least it comes from the right source. The signature is sent back with the answer in an additional resource record. A resource record with a type resource record signature, RRC. Checking the signature of an answer is done with the public part of the key pair. Where can we find the public part of the key pair? The public part of the key pair is in the zone file of the domain name, in our case, somedomain.eu. This information is also a resource record, DNS key. You query for the DNS key from the same name server, in our case, the name server of somedomain.eu. When you receive the public key, this information is also signed. Now, to make it more complex, the DNS key is signed with another private key. There is another key pair, which is used for signing DNS keys. We call this key pair the key signing key, case K. The first key pair used for signing the data is called the zone signing key, the ZSK. We have the DNS key, and with the DNS key we can check the signature of the answer for the IP address for www.somedomainname.eu. If this signature is correct, we can say that the content is correct. But we are not there yet. We assumed that the DNS key was correct. We still need the public key of the KSK to check if the signature of the DNS key was correct. Again, this is asked from the name servers of some domain.eu. Once received, we can check the signature of the DNS key, of the first DNS key, the DNS key used for signing the data. There are still some gaps. We checked the signature of the first DNS key, but we didn't check if the second DNS key signature is correct. The second DNS key, the public part of the KSK. For this, we need some extra information. We need the delegation signer, DS. The DS resource tracker is a transformed DNS key using a mathematical function. This mathematical function is called hashing. Hashing is a transformation of a string of characters into a usual short fixed length value of the original string. In the case of DNS, the DNS key will be transformed in a DS. The DS is not retrieved from the name servers of some domain name.eu, but from the parent name server of some domain name.eu, the name servers of EU. Once again, when you got response of the name servers of EU, this will also be signed, this time with the DNS key of EU. At least now you can check from another source the parents of some domain name.eu if the DNS key used by some domain name.eu is correct. The only thing we need to do is check if the DNS keys after hashing becomes a DS. But it doesn't stop there. We still need to check the DNS keys of EU. For this, we just do the same as we did before. We are going to ask the parent, which in this case are the root name service, for the DS resource records of EU. When we got a response from the root name service, the answer is also signed. Again, we need to check DNS keys, but we cannot ask the parent of the root name service for the DS resource records of the root name service. The root name service don't have parents. But where can we find the DS resource records of the root name service? The answer is easy. Each validating name server in the world has those. The DNS keys of the root name service can be checked with the DS resource records of the root name service locally. The DS resource records of the root name service are securely retrieved via email or other means. There is more to say about DNSSEC, but this is sufficient for this course. There's the DNSSEC 3 resource records, the NSSEC records, and we have the second generation of DNSSEC, DNSSEC BIS. These are items that will be mentioned when we create the DNS keys and store them at EURid. As promised, here are some links to interesting documentation on the internet about DNS and DNSSEC. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, please contact us.